fulfill our purpose and promise. As students and graduates of UTT, show us how to effectively serve you so that our education, knowledge, and skills may find true fulfillment as we learn to do your will. May we ever be aware in everything that we do that knowledge comes from learning and wisdom comes from you. Thank you, O Supreme One. Now, let us bow our heads in a moment of silence for those members of our UTT family who have passed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Alex Hewitt, President of the Executive UTT Student Guild. I ask you kindly to remain standing for the Chancellor's procession as well as the national anthem. Excellency Miss Paula May Weeks, ORTT, President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and Chancellor of the University of Trinidad and Tobago.
May God bless our nation.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon once again, and you may be seated at this time. Her Excellency, Ms. Paula Mae Weeks, ORTT, President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and Chancellor of UTT.
Professor Clement Imbert, Chairman of the Board of Governors, UTT, and other members of the Board of Governors of UTT.
The Most Reverend Dr. Charles Jason Gordon, Archbishop of Port of Spain, Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters.
Mr. Langston Roach, Honorary Doctor of Science.
The family of Mr. Desmond Waith, posthumous Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters.
Mrs. Annette Nicholson Alfred, Honorary Distinguished Fellow.
Professor Prakash Prasad, President of the University of Trinidad and Tobago.
Professor Festus Adoyobo, Vice President, Research, Academic and Student Affairs.
Professor Stephen Joseph, Assistant Vice President, Undergraduate Studies. Orator, Dr. Natalie Pasadi.
Orator, Mr. Richard Peer.
Senior Academic and Corporate Staff of UTT.
Members of the Student Guild and other students of UTT.
Graduates of 2022.
Specially invited guests.
Family members and friends.
Members of the media and the viewing public.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. I now invite Her Excellency, Ms. Paula Mae Weeks, ORTT, President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and Chancellor of the University of Trinidad and Tobago, to declare the graduation ceremony open.
As Chancellor of the University, I declare this ceremony open for the conferment of honorary and higher degrees by the authority of the Academic Council and the Board of Governors.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency, Ms. Paula Mae Weeks, ORTT, President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and Chancellor of the University of Trinidad and Tobago. I now invite the Chairman, Board of Governors of the UTT, Professor Clement Imbert, to address the gathering. Put your hands together and welcome Professor Clement Imbert.
Good day. Good day. Before I begin, let me explain my Star Trek wear today. I had eye surgery about a week and a half ago. I'm fine, but I was told by the doctors to avoid bright lights. So now that I can bend down, I can take it out. Short while. I could have pretended I was just a very cool cat, you know, but I wanted to be honest. Her Excellency, Ms. Paula Mae Weeks, ORTT, President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and Chancellor of UTT, Professor Prakash Prasad, President of UTT, Senior Academic and Corporate Staff of UTT, members of the Student Guild and students of UTT, graduates of 2022 in one of our graduation ceremonies, including today our honorary graduates, Archbishop Charles Jason Gordon, Mr. Langston Roach, Mr. Desmond Waith, posthumously, the all honorary doctors, and distinguished fellow Annette Nicholson Alfred. Family members and friends, members of the media, members of the viewing public, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the University of Trinidad and Tobago's 2022 presentation of graduates, one of the ceremonies between today and Friday. This is a return to in-person celebrations. It is my pleasure to host you all at this magnificent location that is the National Academy for the Performing Arts, part of which houses the university's Academy for the Performing Arts, a venue which over the years has witnessed a vast array of events of great cultural and national significance. At this, the most auspicious of university occasions, there is a celebratory mood in the air as we acknowledge and applaud over 1,500 individuals on their significant academic achievement and commitment to excellence. Each of you has displayed dauntless resolution, particularly over the last 2.5 years, extolling the true character of a learner, and you are now officially a graduate of a very respected entity within the world of academia. That is the National University of Trinidad and Tobago. This year, UTT turns 18, a number which today represents a coming of age in many ways. The achievements attained since the university's inception in 2004 are by all means awe-inspiring and a testament to our unquestionable dedication to meeting and surpassing the vision and mission initially set out almost 2 decades ago. The university, at its core, represents an institution created to bridge the gap between academia, industry, and the society at large, providing tuition in a number of areas which at the time were underrepresented in the country. That was a very ambitious for a brand new academic institution at the time. UTT still continues to serve its purpose and to evolve while amassing accolades for research, entrepreneurship, and innovation, and is a reflection of the efforts and competence of all involved, both staff and faculty, to the benefit of the society, mainly through you as instruments of advancement and change. Today, as the university strides towards proverbial adulthood, it takes its many graduates along with it. So too, you can carry part which is now undeniably embedded in each of you as a representative of the university family, one still cementing its reach across the globe, continuing to achieve so much. sorry for my lilting. It is worth noting some of the latest achievements over the last year of UTT and the UTT family. UTT was engaged by PAHO, WHO, in a project that involves the introduction of robotics and AI into the health system in the region. UTT and Kabiri launched a major recycling project which will convert old discarded tires into rubber crumbs for road pavement and other uses. In January, MADE 868, the fashion production facility of UTT, opened its doors to the public as the only facility which caters to the small and medium production needs of our fashion industry locally and regionally. It's a wonderful facility. I urge you to take a visit. You will be blown away by what you see. UTT fashion alumnus Garrett Richards showcased his collection in Milan, Italy. And UTT mechanical engineering and manufacturing entrepreneurship alumna received a prestigious Chevening scholarship, a fully funded scholarship program which enables outstanding emerging leaders from all over the world to pursue a one-year master's degree in the UK. And this young lady already has a master's from UTT. Kevin Singh, a holder of a BSc in Information Technology and an MSc in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management, and Entrepreneurship, is the founder and owner of Health Mix, a company that develops and produces cakes mixes that utilizes healthier substitutes. One of the main ingredients in his cake mixes is pure flour. He has worked with several local food manufacturers and facilities. I didn't know this before, and I must check him out, because I grew up in San Grande and there were two pure trees just outside my fence. And I still, when I go to San Grande, the first thing I look to buy is kiwa, piwa, or the seedless one that we call karakel. So I must look out for him. Now, past UTT Patriots, this is what we call our sports high-performance players. Samantha Wallace, Jamelia McCarthy, Oprah Douglas, Shaquanda Green-Noel, Anicia Batiste, Khalifa McCullin, all these people from our netball team were drafted into the national team. The number of people you have on a netball court, UTT could play for Trinidad and Tobago without having anybody else. And of course, we had the captain in Miss McCullin and the vice captain in Miss George. So they recently, you may have seen on the TV that they played in a tournament in Jamaica, and they were selected, as I said, for that team. Our netball coach, Dr. Bridget Adams, with a PhD in sport management from UTT, has been appointed President of America's Football. This is a new name for the America's Netball, sorry. This is a new name for the Confederation of Netball Associations in Latin America and the Caribbean. And she will take over as regional director in 2023. UTT Patriots football goalkeeper Alaya Alexander and Tamia Sinclair were selected for Trinidad and Tobago under 20 women's football team. And another football player from Colette Morgan has been selected for the Trinidad and Tobago senior national team. The first set I called were for the under 20. And so it goes on in sport. I don't want to read all the sport accolades. Our tennis coach, Alina Edwards, was selected as national coach of Trinidad and Tobago. Our training officer, Donna Marie Wickham, was selected as one of the rehab specialists for the women's national football team, and so on. To turn to areas of culture and other areas, Dr. Mia Gormandy Benjamin, assistant professor in music, was appointed artistic director of the famous Trinidad All-Stars Seal Orchestra in March this year. An associate professor, Dr. Varma Rambaran, has published a book on alternative medicine for diabetes management, derived from his patented research work, which was funded by a EU grant and involved collaboration at a university in India, where he had to spend some time operating, well, not operating, but working on some rats. At this year's music festival, saxophonist Chavez Benjamin was awarded first place with 100% in the orchestral instrument solo selection of the 2022 Trinidad and Tobago Music Festival. And he was among several others, about five others, who also were awarded trophies in various categories. And to crown it all, UTT APA students was accepted to Yale University. Our students have been accepted to some of the most prestigious universities in the world. We had a student who got a partial scholarship to go to the famous Guildhall in London, one of the five best music and drama schools in the world. He is a Venezuelan student who came here as a refugee, if you like, and we gave him a scholarship, and he has really done us proud. And a student, Kino Alvarez, has been accepted to the prestigious Yale University, United States, to pursue a Master of Fine Arts degree in Technical Design and Production. So, as a graduate of this excellent university, you have astutely proven your ability to cultivate that which is required for success. With encouragement from your support system, family, friends, and well-wishers, and guidance from our exceptional educators, you have managed to elevate yourself to a position where the air is rare. There's a small percentage of people who graduate in Trinidad and Tobago with university degrees. And yet we are one of the highest in the region, but it is still a relatively small percent of the population. At this time, I want to ask you, the graduates, to stand. I hope it is not a problem to stand and turn to your family, friends, and well-wishers, and say thank you by a resounding round of applause. Thank you. You may take your seats. You and they must be proud of this achievement as you take this badge of honor out into the world. Be encouraged to make the progress that you wish to see. Be like so many UTT graduates before you who have established a tradition whereby through their work, they have become ardent proponents of transformational progress and staunch supporters of entrepreneurial growth. These are two key components which we have come to see are requirements for achieving sustainable success on both the individual and wider scale. As part of its mandate for educating future generations, UTT utilizes a unique approach to pedagogy, which on the one hand takes into consideration the wide range of learning abilities of our students, and on the other hand allows them to develop the ability to think critically. The approach revitalizes the way our students learn, which in turn inspires a desire for lifelong learning. The University of Trinidad and Tobago is honored to call each of you a graduate and is privileged to have played an instrumental part in your overall growth. We vow to continue to invest in the future of our nation by supporting its most indispensable resource, particularly the youth. While today's proceedings represent only a snapshot of your totality, do not devalue the magnitude of this accomplishment. This is where you envisioned yourself when you enrolled as a student some years ago of this esteemed institution. You have endured the most trying of situations, particularly, as I said, before the last 2.5 years, and should be brimming with joy at your success. Make sure to celebrate the victory of achievement, to savor the moment before it passes. And again, once more, to be grateful to those who have helped you along the way. It is my duty to inspire confidence in our graduates, to encourage you to be more than a mere spectator, instead an active participant in the cycle of life. Challenge the status quo with your latest qualifications and your critical thinking ability. Contribute, invent, advance. The world yearns for engineers, seafarers, designers, farmers, technicians, educators, policymakers, and so on. The world yearns for you. It is now up to you to add to that which has already been laid. In conclusion, together with the Chancellor, members of the Board of Governors, the staff and faculty of the university, and the national community, I congratulate once more the entire graduating class of 2022. Stand tall on the shoulders of your predecessors with the confidence required to excel. We all celebrate you, and in spite of what may come, do not be dissuaded, as we are sure you will never let us down, and you will never let yourselves down. I salute you all. Thank you very much. I hope you don't mind if I return to my Star Trek persona, yes? Thank you.
I think we often take for granted the number of successes that UTT has achieved. And now I'm so happy to say that we can add you to that list of successes. And I would like to thank Professor Imbert not only for the high level of Star Trek cool that he brought here today, but also for his very warm welcome and reminding us of the successes that we have achieved thus far in our very short lifetime. So thank you very much, Professor Imbert. At this point, we would like to celebrate our honorary graduands. And I will start now. I will call upon Dr. Edward Cumberbatch to deliver the citation for Mrs. Annette Nicholson Alfred.
Honorary Distinguished Fellow Annette Cecile Nicholson Alfred. Mrs. Annette Cecile Nicholson Alfred was born in Charlottesville and attended Charlottesville Methodist Primary School and Bishop's High School, Tobago. She later gained her trained teacher's diploma at Mousica Teachers College and a Master of Arts in Educational Theater at New York University. Mrs. Nicholson Alfred began her professional career as part of the Ministry for Tobago Affairs and then transitioned to the field of education, serving in different capacities at a number of institutions, including Scarborough Methodist Primary School, Scarborough Secondary School, and Sandilands Primary School in the Bahamas. In 1981, she returned to public service as a cultural officer at the Tobago House of Assembly, THA, a position well-suited given her appreciation of the country's culture and heritage. Among her many achievements, Mrs. Nicholson Alfred coordinated the Plymouth Bethesda Best Village Group, was an outstanding member of the Mousica Teachers College Alumni Folk Group, and the founder of the Tobago Academy of Performing Arts, TAPA. In 2001, under her guidance, TAPA won the World Folk Dance Trophy in Wales, UK, and was also credited as the first to introduce the art of ballet and tap dancing to Tobago. In 1975, Mrs. Nicholson Alfred won the Prime Minister's Best Village Awards for Best Actress and Best Playwright, and also received a Best Village Scholarship to study drama. She played a pivotal role in conceptualizing the Tobago Heritage Festival, eventually serving on the committee for 19 years. As leader, her mass band won Tobago Band of the Year 10 times. Mrs. Nicholson Alfred has served as an insightful resource of all things cultural, having introduced a number of programs over the years, not only to the THA's lineup, but also directly to the community. Later in her career, she founded the Itsy Bitsy Playhouse and Folk Theater in 2007 as an ode to Tobago's folklore. As a cultural activist, she was awarded the Public Service Medal of Merit Gold in 2005. The University of Trinidad and Tobago is pleased to confer the title of Honorary Distinguished Fellow upon Mrs. Annette Nicholson Alfred. Chancellor, I present Annette Nicholson Alfred, Honorary Distinguished Fellow.
I now invite Dr. Annette Nicholson Alfred to acknowledge Her Excellency. Congratulations to Dr. Annette Nicholson Alfred. I now call on Dr. Gerald Bisnath to deliver the citation for Mr. Langston Roach. And I will ask kindly that all honorary graduates at the end of your citation to kindly stand to please acknowledge Her Excellency. Thank you.
Honorary Doctor of Science, Langston Roach. Born in Labrie in 1947, Mr. Langston Anthony Herbert Roach spent much of his childhood years in Tobago, attending Scarborough Boys Anglican and Scarborough Methodist Schools, then Bishop's High School, and eventually Queen's Royal College. He studied chemical engineering at the University of the West Indies, and in 1970, he joined the family business. His entrepreneurial and innovative spirit led him to found Langston Roach Industries Limited, LRI, in 1985. The company was born out of his desire to be an entrepreneur and to provide quality household and personal care products at affordable prices. In 1998, he earned an executive master in business administration from the University of the West Indies, Arthur Lockjack Global School of Business. Mr. Roach, who is pivotal in the local manufacturing industry, has been awarded by several institutions, including the Trinidad and Tobago Bureau of Standards, the National Entrepreneurship Development Company Limited, Arthur Lockjack Global School of Business, SAWA Business Association, and the Supermarket Association of Trinidad and Tobago for his contribution and commitment to manufacturing, education, and entrepreneurship. Under his stewardship, LRI has become the largest indigenous manufacturer of household cleaners and personal care products in the country, including brands such as Lanha, Smart Choice, Fire Bright, Soft and Silky, and Nature's Collection. Ever mindful of his civic duty, Mr. Roach remains keen in his support of initiatives and projects in SAWA and the wider community. He has also served as Vice President of the SAWA Business Association and Director of the Trinidad and Tobago Manufacturers Association. After many years at the helm, Mr. Roach has taken a step back from the day-to-day running of LRI. However, he remains the Executive Chairman of both LRI Holdings Limited and LRI Group of Companies. Mr. Langston Roach, an avid gardener who enjoys spending quality time with his 9 grandchildren, remains dedicated to continuously developing the next generation to be the leaders of tomorrow. The University of Trinidad and Tobago is pleased to confer the title of Honorary Doctor of Science upon Langston Roach. Chancellor, I present Langston Roach, Honorary Doctor of Science.
Congratulations to Dr. Langston Roach. I would also like to add that he has a very proud employee graduate in the audience, and she's smiling at me right now. So he'll see her later. I'd also like to thank Dr. Gerald Bisnath for delivering that citation. I now call on Dr. Keila Francis to deliver the citation for Mr. Desmond Wheat.
Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters, posthumous, Desmond Wheat. Mr. Desmond Wheat was an accomplished musician with over 50 years experience in teaching and international consulting related to steel orchestras. He held titles of arranger, choral conductor, orchestral conductor, and musical consultant. After attending Fatima College and Mausiga Teachers College, where he received a diploma in education, Mr. Wheat became a member of the Trinidad and Tobago Regimental Band. It was during this time he earned a grade 8 certificate in music from the Royal School of Music. As a regional coordinator in the Ministry of Education, Mr. Wheat played an instrumental role in overseeing the management of the Pan in this classroom unit. One of his many accomplishments was working with the Hartford Conservatory and Artist Collective in Connecticut, USA, to develop the curriculum and teach music theory, both related to steel band music. In Trinidad, Mr. Wheat continued his contribution to academia and culture as a music teacher at Belmont Boys Secondary School. He later joined the University of Trinidad and Tobago's Academy for the Performing Arts as senior instructor in steel band. While serving as musical director of the Exodus Steel Orchestra, he triumphantly led the EXO Cubs Junior Steel Orchestra to the Junior Panorama title in 2001. Mr. Wheat was also musical director of the BP Renegade Steel Orchestra, arranging and conducting the band's performances at the La Folle Journée de Nantes Festival in France from 2008 to 2020, as well as their performances in Japan and Germany. Under his directorship, the Marionettes Chorale was twice awarded Best Choir at music festivals in both England and Trinidad. Desmond Wheat, for his contribution to culture, was a recipient of the Hummingbird Medal Silver in 1993, three Cacique Awards, and awards from Tunapuna Piako Regional Corporation and the City of Port of Spain. The University of Trinidad and Tobago is pleased to confer the posthumous title of Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters upon Mr. Desmond Wheat. Chancellor, the certificate for Desmond Wheat, Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters, posthumously, is being accepted by his wife, Melissa Lynch Wheat.
We congratulate Dr. Wheat and thank his family for accepting this award on his behalf. I now call on Dr. Ruby Allen to deliver the citation for His Grace, the Reverend Dr. Jason Charles Gordon.
Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters, the Most Reverend Charles Jason Gordon, Archbishop of Port of Spain. Archbishop Charles Jason Gordon was born in 1959. He graduated from Fatima College and subsequently took over the family business consequent to the untimely passing of his father. In 1981, he entered the Living Water community where he began his spiritual journey. Shortly thereafter, he commenced his seminary formation at the Seminary of St. John Vianney and the Uganda Martyrs, Mount St. Benedict. 5 years later, Archbishop Gordon graduated with a Bachelor of Arts degree in theology with first class honors from the University of the West Indies. He also earned a master's degree in theology and a Bachelor of Arts in philosophy from the Catholic University of Leuven in Belgium. In 1991, he was ordained as a priest and completed the Doctor of Philosophy from Heythrop at Jesuit College, University of London. He was ordained as Bishop of Bridgetown, Barbados, and installed as Bishop of the Diocese of Bridgetown, and also served as the Vice President of the Antilles Episcopal Conference of Bishops and the Chair of Evangelization Commission. In the sphere of academia, His Grace has lectured in theology and has taught Caribbean history, social ethics, media, and Caribbean technology. He was also the principal of the Caribbean School of Catholic Communications, ARIMA, Trinidad. He founded the Community Intervention Transforming Youth Program, referred to as CITY, to assist with community development. The CITY project engaged numerous stakeholders, including the City of Port of Spain and the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee, both of which honored him for his initiative. Among his numerous achievements is his delivery of the prestigious Carl J. Peter Lecture on Preaching at the North American College in Rome, and the homily at the official ecumenical service of the 2017 G20 meeting in Hamburg, Germany. In addition to presenting a paper at the CARIFESTA 13 Symposium on Caribbean Culture and Identity, His Grace has a number of publications related to his faith. Archbishop Gordon's service to the Catholic community includes social justice appointments, religious guidance for both print media and television, hosting of workshops, and providing training in theology and spirituality. His Grace also implemented the Trinidad chapter of the Global Catholic Climate Movement to address the impact of global warming in this country. As part of the Evangelization Commission, he has engaged regional consultants who work to let no one go hungry, physically, spiritually, or in any other way. As Archbishop of Port of Spain, His Grace continues to work with at-risk communities, non-governmental organizations, and the private sector to improve the quality of life for all. The University of Trinidad and Tobago is pleased to confer the title of Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters upon Charles Jason Gordon. Chancellor, I present His Grace, the Reverend Dr. Charles Jason Gordon, Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters.
Congratulations to His Grace, the Reverend Dr. Jason Charles Gordon. I think we should congratulate all our honorary graduates once more. As we thank them for their outstanding contributions to national development, I would like to invite His Grace, the Reverend Dr. Jason Charles Gordon, to bring remarks on behalf of the honorees. I now invite you, the Reverend Dr. Jason Charles Gordon, Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters.
Good Graduates, congratulations to you. You pressed forward, I'm sure, under very challenging circumstances, and here you are today. Here you are today. Yeah, give yourselves a round of applause. When I was a teen, my father had a sailboat called Matabili. And one Tuesday during the holidays, we were down in Scotland Bay. And when we set out to come back to port, we had a little challenge. There was no breeze. A little sailboat, you know, needs some breeze. I said, all right, so we turned on the engine and we were motoring back up. And just outside Tetron, the engine conked out. And there was a ferocious Remu current pulling us back through the first boka. And in the midst of this wonderful challenge, I said to my father, we have the dinghy and a little outboard engine. Let me tow the boat. So I put the engine on the dinghy, launched, went, put a rope, and started to try to tow this yacht. And I had my engine all out. And although I was doing everything I could, all I did was manage to slow down the rate at which we were going backwards. But sometimes that is progress, because we didn't get out of the first boka, and we didn't get into real peril. I should tell you that this little engine came about because when we were in Bekwe, Dad went into a shop, and as he was shopping, I looked around and I saw three scrap heaps of parts, and I started to pull pieces from each of the scrap heaps, and he said, what are you doing? I said, that heap that I've just made, that's an engine. He said, are you sure? And the fella sold it for nearly nothing, and I put it together happily and got it to work by a miracle. Sometimes, you know, we have to do things that are interesting, innovative. And sometimes we have to do things against all odds. You are graduating into one of the most dynamic moments of history. You know, for 500 years, the scientific revolution has had its sway and given us incredible progress. 500 years, we have benefited from technology, from science, from innovation. We have cultivated the mind in a way that no civilization has done before. We have the electronic microscope that could look 500,000 times into the smallest particle, and the new James Webb telescope that can see the outer reaches of space, where we could see the beginnings of time itself. When we recognize where we are as a society, as a global people, there are very strong global currents that are pushing us as a little nation, as a little region. And these mighty currents that are moving against us are somewhat perilous at times. You know, we believe that through science, through technology, and through the cultivation of the mind, that we would solve all problems, that we would build the kingdom of God here on earth, and that we would end global poverty, that we would end all wars, and that we would usher in an era of peace. And as we look around, we are now on the brink of a war that could be continental, that could be nuclear. And rationality that brought about these weapons hasn't cultivated the human conscience and soul to understand how and why technology should be used and when it ought not to be used. We have an oil addiction in the Western world, and through this oil addiction, we have gone close to war many, many times, and again right now. And because of this oil addiction, despite Russia's push on peace in Europe, Russia has increased its oil earnings by 38% during this war. And we can't do anything because we need the oil. We're facing an ecological disaster. The UN has said that we have reached places now that are unsustainable and irreparable, and that the ecological challenge that we face is escalating at a rate far faster than we ever imagined. Two-fifths of the planet is in poverty, and despite all that we have with such excess, we still have so many people living in poverty. 50 million people are living in slavery. That's far, far more than the transatlantic slave trade that formed our region and our nation. René Descartes, in an attempt to solve the problem of knowledge, how do I know that I know anything at all, came up with his famous formula, cogito ergo sum. I think, therefore I am. And this sleight of hand, he turned the human being to be the center of knowledge of everything else. And so the I becomes more important than the we. And the I becomes more important than the community, the nation, or the world. Immanuel Kant has challenged rationality and shown that pure reason has its own irrationality built into it. And we are here where we are, with these global currents pushing against us in such ferocious ways, because we have overplayed one dimension of the human, the mind, the rational dimension of the human. But in doing so, we have been underplaying other dimensions of the human heart, the human spirit, the human capacity for love. The global currents are pushing us as a nation and as a region into very perilous places. And we might not have what we need to move the ship of state out of the peril. But maybe if we had a little engine that we could construct from a scrap heap somewhere, maybe, just maybe, we could avoid the worst of the peril. As a civilization, we have conquered the highest peaks of knowledge that are before us, and yet the inner landscape of the human heart remains, for the most part, a desolate, uncultivated landscape. And as much as we have done with knowledge and technology, is as poor as we have become in humanity, in the heart, in the soul, in what is most important that makes us most human. The future of humanity is at stake from all these big global currents. And we need to find a way to move this ship that seems to have its sails fluttering in the breeze and to have no engine at this time to move us. We need to find a way to move out of peril. My thesis is that the fundamental challenge facing Trinidad and Tobago and the world as a whole is a challenge of the heart. It is a spiritual challenge. We are in a spiritual crisis. Albert Einstein has famously said, "You cannot solve a problem at the same level of thinking that we were at when we created the problem in the first place." And so we have to ask, how do we solve these great challenges that we face? And while we need mind, technology, innovation, there's another dimension of the human that we have been sadly lacking. The motivation of the heart remains an enigma to us. And although we have been so advanced in so many ways, when it comes to the face-to-face relationships between people, between groups, and between societies and civilizations, we seem so poor that we could allow a war to escalate with so many nuclear weapons around. Politically, if I look at the local currents in Trinidad and Tobago, there was a Nigel Henry poll in 2019 that says, we are so racially divided that governance and politics can't work easily. Because one tribe, when they're in power, the other tribe think they're doing a terrible job. But their tribe think they're doing really well. And the other tribe, when they're in power, the next tribe think they're doing a terrible job. But their tribe thinks they're doing very well. We are in an age where there is no political engine right now to move us from the perils that we are facing in this state. Our murder rate has been in the top 7 of the nations of the world, which is crazy. And just yesterday, the children of Rose Hill had to duck under their benches and their tables as gunfire was happening for a minute and a half outside, traumatizing an entire school. We've had 15 murders in a 72-hour period recently. And when it comes to corruption, we're number 52. And that's not a nice number to have. The higher up you go, the less corrupt you are. We're 52 down that chain. We've changed governments, ministers of national security, police commissioners. And the murder rate and the corruption does not change easily. In fact, when it changes, it goes up and not down. David Rudder said in his song, Another Day in Paradise, he starts the song by saying, forged. That is the first word of the anthem. We're so damn corrupt, that is the problem. In 1985, we had a visit from Dr. Bromley, who was an expert in substance abuse. And when he visited Trinidad to do a program called Chemical People to bring drug awareness, as he walked the streets of the city and met all sorts of people, he was in shock. Because in 1985, the use of cocaine in Trinidad was far worse than it was on the streets of America, that he had seen as an expert. And he said to us then, if you do not do something very seriously right now, you will not recognize your country in 20 years' time. I'm afraid Dr. Bromley was right. At the heart of the corruption and at the heart of the gangs and at the heart of the problem that we have is illegal gangs, illegal drugs, and illegal guns on our cities and in our streets and in every place that we have. We have a culture of disrespect that is so real that you hear it in the talk shows, you hear it in how we speak to one another. These are problems of the soul. These are problems of the spirit. These are problems of the heart. There was a cabinet minister in the 1980s who brought to cabinet the problem of the drug culture and said to cabinet that we know who the drug leaders are, and he called names. That evening, and this is in the 1980s, he got a call saying, your wife was at such and such a place and your children were at such and such a place. If you continue, we know how to find you. And the only people he spoke to were people in the cabinet at the time. The outbreak of the party, the hedonism, the nakedness, the pleasure, this pursuit of money, is really a spiritual problem, because when we don't feel good inside of ourselves, we try to solve that problem by external stimulation. And when you look at us, it's not just that we're having fun. It is that we've gone to a culture of nakedness and indecency. Jam naked and hypersexuality seems to be the order of the day. Dr. Williams, on the eve of independence, said to this nation, there can be no Mother India or no Mother Africa, no Mother China or no Mother Europe. There can be only one Mother, Mother Trinidad and Mother Tobago. And a mother cannot discriminate against her children. And the children cannot continue to disrespect each other. These are the problems of the soul. We are addicted to money and to sensuality and pleasure seeking, to honor and to wealth. We live with such disrespect. We're in a kind of an escapism at the moment because we can't face the reality of what we're facing, and because things are so difficult for all of us in this beautiful little country. I suppose you can say, quoting a song from yesteryear, we've been looking for love in all the wrong places, in all the wrong spaces. And having not found it, we keep at the activity, not getting better. We are adrift as a nation, as we've never been before. And global currents are pushing us in some directions that we really don't want to go. And local currents are pushing us also in directions that are perilous. And I would say to you, you know, look in the scrap heap of what was discarded from your grandmother and your great-grandmothers and see if we can't find enough parts to put together a little engine. A little engine that might help us at least to slow down the rate at which we're going backwards, if not to move us forward into a safer place. Aristotle has said that about happiness, no one would call a man ideally happy if he has not got a particle of courage, nor temperance, nor decency, nor the good sense, but is afraid of the flies that flutter by him, cannot refrain from any of the most outrageous actions in order to gratify a desire to eat or to drink, and ruins his dearest friends for the sake of a penny. Happiness cannot be found by pursuit of money, by pursuit of pleasure, by pursuit of power, or by pursuit of honor. These roads have been closed off 2,300 years ago by Aristotle. And he says to us, if you want to understand what happiness means, it is about wealth, but not in the sense of money, but in the sense of friendship, in the sense of wisdom, and in the sense of virtue. And unless we become a people who are friends, deeply friends with one another, who are pursuing knowledge in its deepest and most profound sense, and seeking virtue in everything, we will not find happiness, not in our time. Virtue is the key to true friendship, but it is also the key to knowledge. And virtue is part of this little engine that we must reconstruct if we're going to move from where we are to a place of true happiness. Remember what Einstein said, you can't solve a problem at the same level at which you created it. The politicians, the business leaders, the religious leaders, community leaders have tried solving the problem, and we see the result. Look in the scrap heap and find the parts to build a little engine. Because the truth is, all of us, if we found that little engine that we could construct, and if each of us used that little engine, we find a way to move this gigantic ship into safe harbor and then set it on a course that would be more meaningful than the directions we are in right now. Perennial philosophy and religion, when we look at all our religious traditions, there's three things that they hold in common. The first is a golden rule. The second is a care for the poor. And the third is our mystical tradition of unity and union with the divine and all of humanity. And that's whether we talk of Hinduism, Islam, or Christianity as the major religions in our lands. Revival of our nation requires of us finding a new consciousness. And this means exploring a new space. And this means while we are reveling in the technologies and the knowledge, we also have to start reveling in the space of the heart, the soul, and of the spirit. We all want someone else to solve the problem for us. And we all want to give it to the politician and ask them, or the trade union leader, or the pundit, or the imam, or the pastor, or the priest, or the university. But the truth is, they cannot. They cannot solve the problem. Not unless each one of us is willing to be part of that solution. We all have a part to play. We all have to make our contribution. And even if you think all you have is a little piece of engine, in the face of a ship that is so big, be as naive as I was when I was 16 years old. And use your engine to move this ship in a new direction. The golden rule says, treat others as you want them to treat you. And this is found in every nation, in every culture, every language, and every religion. And if we start constructing a value system in Trinidad and Tobago based on the golden rule, we can all agree at least upon that as a minimum agreement of values. The care for the poor is part of the golden rule. How would you like to be treated if you were in that position? And if we understand that, then when we have a little community like Rose Hill where the gunfire is so rapid, and other communities where the education is poor because these are poor communities that do not have the resources that they need, then we have to understand that the education system has to privilege our poorest communities and give them the best resources possible to ensure all of our children get an education that will move them out of poverty and to become a solid citizen of this beautiful and beloved country we call Trinidad and Tobago. Our mystical tradition is part of what unifies all of us. The Sufi tradition from Islam and the Hindus have their own mystical tradition. And so do we Christians. And at the heart of the mystical tradition is always that there is a sacrifice to be paid if we want to become and evolve to a better consciousness. Sacrifice is part and parcel of the evolution process of consciousness. And in our culture, we do not want to pay sacrifice. In our culture, we want it all, we want it up front. But in a world gone wrong, communion can only be built on sacrifice. And in a nation gone wrong, prosperity, true wealth, and true happiness can only be built on sacrifice. Your grandmother and your great-grandmother knew what I'm talking about. Look at their lives again and pull from their lives the parts that we need to construct the engine that will move us from where we are in peril to a nation of which we can all be proud. Gratitude is one of the keys of spirituality. Any truly spiritual person is a person of gratitude. And when you meet people who have ingratitude, you know that they have no spirit, no heart, no soul. The old people used to tell us, you know, ingratitude is worse than witchcraft. Practice gratitude every single day. Find things for which you are grateful in your life every single day. Treat people as you want to be treated and find a pathway for union with your God. Then, if each one of us here put a little engine on a little dinghy and start pulling at this mighty nation, Trinidad and Tobago, we might move this nation and we might move our people and we might chart a new course. And then every creed and race will find an equal place, and then the angels will add, and may God bless our nation.
Thank you very much, Your Grace, the Reverend Dr. Jason Charles Gordon, Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters. And how graphically you captured the perilous times, the global and local challenges. But this evening, an evening of celebration, I feel, it is a week of celebration for UTT, because all of these people who are graduating here are going to go out and make a difference. They are going to be the engines of change. They are going to be the people who are going to transform, who are going to inspire. I feel at this time, you are at least reminded that the journey now starts. Okay, so to all of you, go out there with the power. Thank you, Your Grace, for that moving tribute. To all of our graduates, you possess the power to transform. And we're going to work hard, because I love Trinidad and Tobago. And I think we are great, and I feel great about the human spirit. We have an indomitable human spirit and a tenacity and a resilience. We can overcome these challenges. And at this time, we do it in song. May the Road Rise, composed by UTT's Associate Professor of Music and overall program leader of UTT's Academy for the Performing Arts, under the superb direction of Dr. Roger J. Henry, APA, gives us May the Road Rise. Put your hands together and welcome them.
What a wonderful rendition of May the Road Rise. I remind you that this was done by our own choir, upper choir, very superbly led by Dr. Roger J. Henry. Let us applaud them once more. And now, for the moment that you've really been waiting for. Yes, I know. I know there were times over the years where you wondered if you would even get here. And I know some of those those thoughts were directed specifically to me. I know that, right? So, all right, so now we have the award of the postgraduate degrees. Professor Festus Adoyogo, please present to the Chancellor those persons who have met the requirements of the University of Trinidad and Tobago and are to be admitted to their respective postgraduate degrees. Professor?
Well, I know you've been waiting for this time. You've been students of UTT, you are graduates now, and in a few moments when you're handed your degree, you become graduates. So what can I say? You've had a lot of wisdom that has come here. I would like you to go out there and remember the word cogito, think and create, and you will do great things. We are always here for you, and we are very proud of you. Chancellor, I ask you to admit these candidates from these academic programs, having fulfilled the requirements of the university, to the postgraduate, master's, and doctoral degrees for which they are presented. So I will first announce the title of the degree, and then I will mention the names. Postgraduate Diploma in Education. Fatima Abdullah Mohammed. Anika Kimberly Baku. Anika Kimberly Baku. Alexi Mary Cromwell. Francisca DeFore Phillips, Alicia Cheryl Ann De Silva, Jermaine Cecilia De Vital. Giselle Elizabeth Fraser Washington. Carvel Harry, Govinda Ramlogan, Ato Kenya Rodcliffe. Taramati Sudama Sigubin. Masters in Health Administration, Health Systems, Brenda John. Rajiv Piyush Nagasar. Alison, Masters in Health Administration, Alison Denali Gajada. Lizette Avion McLean. Master of Arts in Carnival Studies, Hadin Daisley. Master of Arts in Carnival Studies, Shailene Teresa Hendrickson. Master of Arts in Carnival Studies, Trevin Lane Bailey. Master of Arts in Carnival Studies, Stacy Glennie Subes Abraham. Master of Education in Educational Technology with option in Interactive Learning and Systems Development, Zainab Abdallah. Master of Education in Educational Technology with option in Classroom Technology Development and Usage, Gillian Varuna Kani. Master of Education in Educational Technology with option in Interactive Learning Systems Development, Beverly Allen Hamlet. Master of Education in Educational Technology with option Interactive Learning Systems Development, Kayreen Maria Mendoza-Rallet. Master of Education in Educational Technology with option in Classroom Technology Development and Usage, Garnel F. Ramikisun. Master of Science in Cybersecurity, Allison Nelson. Master of Science in Energy Engineering with specialization in renewable energy, Vishal Brandon Boudou. Master of Science in Energy Engineering with specialization in renewable energy, Stephen Fenton Jagiel. Master of Science in Energy Engineering, specialization renewable energy, Kiran Ramroop. Master of Science, Energy Engineering, Specialization, Renewable Energy, Stefan Miguel Randall. Master of Science, Energy Engineering, Specialization in Renewable Energy, Brian Christian Ranville. Taylor C. Robinson, Master of Science in Energy Engineering, Specialization Renewable Energy. Scott Walter St. John, Master of Science, Energy Engineering, Specialization in Renewable Energy. Vanessa Vincent, Master of Science, Energy Engineering, Specialization in Renewable Energy. Master of Science in Information and Communication Technology, Gentry Alfonso. Master of Science in Information and Communication Technology, Denise Deanne Caesar. Master of Science in Information and Communication Technology, Shanice Abenakujo. Master of Science in Information and Communication Technology, Tepsa Kenwin Harris. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management and Entrepreneurship, Tricia Asiu. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management and Entrepreneurship, Stefan Joshua Baran. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management and Entrepreneurship, Sarah Bodram. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing Management and Entrepreneurship, Charlene Carla Kujo. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management, Entrepreneurship, Sharon Francis Jeffrey. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management and Entrepreneurship, Samantha Mary Gonzalez Vargas. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management and Entrepreneurship, Amrita Amy Mahabir. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management and Entrepreneurship, Gamsan Junior Mohammed. Well done. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management and Entrepreneurship, Rihanna Latoya Paul. Master of Science in Innovation, Manufacturing, Management and Entrepreneurship, Roxanne Natasha Richards. Master of Science in Innovative Design and Entrepreneurship, Carlon Moses Cayenne. Master of Science in Innovative Design and Entrepreneurship, Abiruz Mahabir. Master of Science in Innovative Design and Entrepreneurship, Kamau C. Romano. Master of Science in Innovative Design and Entrepreneurship, David R. K. Sharma. Master of Science in Innovative Design and Entrepreneurship, Nakhil Aquil Woods. Master of Science in Integrated Coastal and Ocean Management, Arvind Narendra Dagasar. Master of Science in Integrated Coastal and Ocean Management. Master of Science in Integrated Coastal and Ocean Management, Andre Terence Sterling. Master of Science in Integrated Coastal and Ocean Management, Eugenia Crystal Thomas. Master of Science in Operational Maritime Management, Kieron Armugam. Master of Science in Petroleum Engineering, Jeremy Richard Dubare. Master of Science in Petroleum Engineering, Suchin Nicola Siling. Chancellor, I now wish to present the degrees for those who have earned the doctoral, the highest degree that we award here, the PhD. So I'll first read out the names, and then the citation, and then the degree. The first two PhDs are actually awarded posthumously. Unfortunately, the candidates are not here with us. However, UTT has the honor to offer them and to award them PhD degrees posthumously. The first candidate is answer properly. Right. Gregor Ephraim Breedy. Gregor is awarded the PhD in Cultural Studies. Unfortunately, he's not able to be with us here, as I've mentioned. Okay. Gregor had many achievements in the Prime Minister's Better Village program and in other cultural roles. He graduated from UTT with a Master of Arts in Carnival Studies. His research was completed with a different focus and pathway for many. He emphasized on an approach and methodology embedded in social theory and called for a wide array of approaches which stressed performances, audience participation, interviews with dancers from various backgrounds. Gregor applied the theory of the French folklorist Arnold van Gennep to limbo, delineating and utilizing the ceremonial stages of a ritual of rites with that display, preliminal, liminal, and postliminal stages. Gregor was not only able to depict the origins of the dance in West Africa, but also to uncover the many unusual steps and movements within the dance itself, and the many contributors from Trinidad and Tobago. The themes within the limbo involved captivity, colonization, redemption, triumph, and these have contributed to making limbo a stamp that reflects Caribbean history in its many facets and features. His work has had and will continue to have a great impact on dance promoters, lecturers, and teachers. It has elevated dance and dance legacy to a high level of pride and its dancers to great self-esteem. Gregor's work could encourage future generations to develop the limbo into a national dance. The certificate will be presented to the family of Gregor Ephraim Breedy after this event. The second PhD goes to Zephaniah Ephrahas Haripal. Zephaniah is not with us because he is passed on. Okay. Zephaniah's doctoral degree investigated optimized drilling fluids and their performance. Zephaniah was a shift work supervisor and drilling fluids technical professional at Tucker Engine Energy Services. He holds a Master of Science degree in Public Sector Management from UWI. He has a Bachelor in Business Computing from SAMAS and NATD from UTT. At a very early stage in his career, he became a junior expert and provided technical support in designing drilling fluids for top operators in the oil and gas industry, both locally and internationally. Zephaniah was multi-talented. His duties were not only technical, but in his lifetime, he was assigned managerial responsibilities in business operations within the Ministry of Education. Mr. Haripal's doctoral research investigated and optimized drilling fluid performance using nanoparticles, that's nanotechnology, for better rheology, sag resistivity, little fluid loss at higher temperatures and pressures, and high angle drilling to enable access to deeper oil reserves. He published his work on management and drilling fluids in peer-reviewed journals and local fora. Outside academia, Zephaniah, a talented fellow, was also an experienced musician. He learned to play the piano at the age of 7 and played the instrument at his church for 18 years. He also taught music for 10 years Zephaniah's certificate will be presented to his family after this event. Zephaniah's father is here, I gather. So. Mr. Sheridan Paul will collect the degree on behalf of his son. Okay, so please. PhD in education is awarded to Webster Matthew Joseph. Webster is a primary school teacher at his alma mater, Clarkson Bay Senior Anglican Primary. His motivation for his research was his desire to improve reading and comprehension skills of students. Mr. Joseph has a Bachelor of Education in Primary Education from UTT. He holds a Master of Education in Health Promotion with distinction from the University of the West Indies. And he has eventually returned to UTT to read this for his Doctor of Philosophy degree. His research explores the effect of explicit comprehension strategy instruction on reading comprehension and developing readers at the primary school level in Trinidad. In 2021, he independently presented aspects of his PhD research at a conference addressing the theme of multiple dimensions in school violence. Since completing his doctoral work, Mr. Joseph has been involved in sharing his work with other educators and educational institutions in Trinidad. He hosted his first postdoctoral workshop at his school to present his doctoral research, as well as interventions and strategies to foster the reading comprehension skills of students. He has been actively networking with other stakeholders in education to conduct similar workshops across the country. He hopes his research will provide empirical evidence to inform and develop education policy in Trinidad and Tobago. Mr. Webster Matthew Joseph. The next candidate is awarded a PhD in process engineering. Mr. Dylan Esaram Souk. Dylan Isaramsu graduated from UTT with an MEng in process engineering in 2018. He continued his studies at UTT, pursuing a PhD degree in the same area, process engineering, where his research focused on clean production, sustainable development, and low to zero carbon technologies. His data-driven research answers critical technical and economic questions that Trinidad and Tobago and other similar small island developing states must answer to achieve pragmatic energy transitions to a low carbon future. His work identifies the most impactful actions that can be adopted in national strategies for sustainably to meet the Paris Agreement. His research demonstrated the relationship between various technical energy supply modifications and the associated financial costs subject to the emission reductions targets of Trinidad and Tobago. In 2022, he's expected to represent UTT among a cohort of 50 persons in the Carbon Capture and Storage Summer School in Indonesia. This summer school will focus on enhancing capabilities through the most recent trends and developments in carbon capture and storage. He is currently a senior associate at PricewaterhouseCoopers with the responsibility for advising and executing projects relating to sustainable strategies, organizational reforms, and business optimization for both public and private sector clients. Dylan believes his specialization, his energy, his determination for success, and his resilience are the tools needed to navigate the complexities of his current professional role and academic research. He aspires for his research to catalyze and change energy planning for reducing carbon footprint in Trinidad and Tobago and elsewhere. Dylan Isaramsu. PhD in Health Administration is awarded to Claudine Petrolena Richardson Shepard. Mrs. Claudine Richardson Shepard is a registered nurse and a full-time lecturer at the UWE School of Nursing in Leadership, Organizational Behavior, Quality Management in the healthcare sector. Her previous appointments include Chief Executive Officer and General Manager Quality at the Northwest Regional Health Authority and Hospital, and is also a hospital administrator. She is a hospital administrator at the Port of Spain General Hospital. Her objective is to apply her experience to the development of a cadre of highly trained professionals and nursing administrators who will contribute to transforming the healthcare sector for the better in Trinidad and Tobago. She has a master's in health administration from UTT and a Bachelor of Arts degree in business administration from the Commonwealth University. Mrs. Richardson Shepard has published on cultural influences on mental health provision, obesity indices and cardiovascular disease, leadership for nurses, and a book chapter on the healthcare systems. Currently, She's a fellow and world expert on the International Society for Quality in Healthcare. This position allows her to give advice on current and new healthcare quality systems and programs. She evaluates healthcare services, educational activities, and helps to further innovation in healthcare, supporting quality and safety in lower and middle income countries. She pursues actively healthcare research and development. She's a member of the Board of Trustees of COSTART and also a member of its Academic and Audit Committee. Claudine Petrona Richardson Shepherd, PhD, Health Administration. PhD in Sports Studies is awarded to Atu Kenya Rodcliffe. Okay. Brother Atu Kenya Rodcliffe is a senior instructor at UTT, Center for Kinesiology, Physical Education and Sport. He considers it a blessing to have been involved in social development through sports as an educator and a practitioner for over 16 years. His certification includes a Bachelor of Science in Sociology, an International Master's in Sports for Development, and a Professional Certificate in High-Level Facilitation from the Community Research and Development Association of South Africa. His doctoral thesis focused on the process towards graduateness and employability. Atu has presented at conferences and workshops in 9 regional jurisdictions, including Jamaica, St. Lucia, Suriname. Internationally, he has made presentations in Brazil, Scotland, South Africa, and Zambia. Atu has been part of the Caribbean Sport Development Agency and that family since 2008, assuming lead directorship in 2021. He served UCC since 2010. He also serves on the board of directors of the Trinidad and Tobago Non-Communicable Disease Alliance and as a member of UNICEF Advisory Board on International Safeguards for Children in Sport. At his core, Atu considered himself a love warrior and someone who is committed to social development and justice. He unreservedly declares in the spirit of piety that he is who he is because of the love, kindness, and sacrifice of other people, especially his parents. Atu's commitment to constant and honest self-examination begins with his love for and the responsibility to his children, parents, partner, students, friends, and extended family. This love and responsibility are extended to all of humanity. Grounded in the Ubuntu philosophy, Atu strives to be a rootsman intellectual concerned with loving and serving the people. He is and always shall be a rootsman from Alboystown, Guyana, son of Eze and Joycelyn Rocklin, one of a kind. Atu, PhD in Sports Studies. Alex is a PhD in criminology and public safety. PhD criminology and public safety is awarded to Troy Emilio Smith. Troy is a trained professional with 14 years of local and international experience in data collection, analysis, and strategy development. He has sat on several panels, committees, and planning groups, including command centers, where he was responsible for and aided in the development of threat assessment, training materials, and occupational standard for use in the region. Mr. Smith holds a Bachelor of Science in Chemistry and has completed postgraduate studies in the American Military University in areas such as advanced cybercrime, geospatial information systems, and analytics. His doctoral dissertation focused on cybercrime victimization trends in Trinidad and Tobago and examination of the etiology of cybercrime. In 2022, he started an executive MBA with Formato Educativo Escuela de Negocios, Spain, funded by an organization, by the Organization of American States Scholarship. Mr. Smith has multiple publications in peer-reviewed journals, academic posters, and conference presentations on topics such as intelligence operations, cyber warfare, cyber terrorism, cybercrime, and online addiction. His work on TikTok addiction has been highlighted by numerous online news outlets. Mr. Smith has engaged in joint research with scholars from United Arab Emirates, South Wales, and Barbados. Currently, he's a project leader of research at the Center for Expertise Cybersecurity in the Netherlands, and a collaborator in joint projects with research from universities in Poland, Germany, and Jamaica. He recently became a collaborator in the Polish Cross-Cultural Psychology Center for Study on Just War Beliefs. He has also been invited to present at the fourth annual Human Factor in Cybercrime Conference in Florida, and in 2022, National Health Research Conference. Mr. Smith is dedicated to using his skills and knowledge born from the dedication of his supervisors at UTT to expand research into cybercrime and online behavior in the Caribbean and contribute to the safety and security of its citizens. PhD Criminology and Public Safety, Troy Emilio Smith.
Thank you, Professor Festus Adoyobo, Vice President, Research, Academic and Student Affairs. Thank you, Your Excellency. That was a long haul. Your Excellency, Ms. Paula Mee. Thank you for standing for that long period of time. And to you, the graduates, it's an evening of celebration. I haven't heard cheers from you. Hip, hip! To all our graduates, you have committed yourself to the business of the value of education. You have persevered, you have shown the courage, and you have reached the end. But the end is merely the beginning, because I would like to draw again from His Grace the motif of the engine. And I would also like to appeal to the media. We get all of the bad news. What about good news of six graduations from the University of Trinidad and Tobago, where we are turning out many, many engines to transform? So, media, take note. A week of graduation ceremonies from the University of Trinidad and Tobago. Once again, congratulations to all of you. engines of change. And now to the business of the UTT Alumni Association. The objectives of the UTT Alumni Association are to promote interaction among alumni members and between alumni and UTT. Remember what His Grace said about, and it's also said in a song, fate of the heart, our consciousness. We aren't just labels and certificates. Wonderful that we get the accolades, but we must prove ourselves worthy of the titles. Shailene, I expect in a calypso that we're sending out engines from the north, from the south, from the and from the west. I'm expecting that. The UTT alumni also encourages education, research, and commercialization of innovative ideas. They keep members informed on the progress of UTT. They mentor undergraduate, postgraduate students through co-op training or similar work-related experiences. They provide professional development training opportunities for its members, recognize alumni achievement. You may join the UTT Alumni Association by going to the UTT website at www.u.tt. And now it gives me great pleasure to call on Mr. Kempes Charles, President of the Alumni Association, as he leads the graduates. And I want to hear you all, remember you all are powerful engines, lead them in the alumni pledge. Mr. Kempes Charles.
All protocols observed. It's always a pleasure when we join in these beautiful ceremonies. So at this time, I would like to ask all the graduates to please stand as we recite the alumni oath. So it is a happy time, so you all could smile. And let me hear you all say it out loud. As alumni of the University of Trinidad and Tobago, we solemnly swear to uphold the honorable traditions of our university, imbued by the spirit of innovation and entrepreneurship, which is at the center of UTT's mission. We will endeavor to lend creativity and passion to all that we undertake. As graduates of the National University, we also commit ourselves to the highest standards of service to our community and country. We will further strive to earn our own place among UTT's alumni, who, by their devotion to these ideals, have brought recognition and honor to our alma mater. We will provide moral, intellectual, and financial support, and will encourage others to attend our alma mater and thus to contribute to the perpetuation of the necessary and noble work of UTT. Welcome.
You could sit down now, you did it well. Congratulations once again. And thank you, Mr. Kempis Charles, President of the Alumni Association. And now once again, the international language, music, the APA choir renders from now on from the greatest showman under the superb direction of Dr. Roger J. Henry. Do welcome them, put your hands together from now on. This country is so blessed with talent. Thank you, APA Choir, lovely music. Thank you, Dr. Roger Henry, UTT's Associate Professor of Music and overall Program Leader of the Academy for Performing Arts. Once again, your appreciation for them. So from now on, we're going out as engines of change. So that's how we're leaving today. Celebration mode and feeling that power. Okay. Congratulations again. I now call on Her Excellency Miss Paula Mae Weeks, ORTT, President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago and Chancellor of the University of Trinidad and Tobago, to declare the ceremony closed.
By the authority vested in me, I officially delegate my duties as Chancellor to Professor Prakash Persad, President of the University of Trinidad and Tobago, for the remaining graduation sessions. I sincerely congratulate the newly graduated members of our society on their achievement, and I now declare this ceremony closed.
As we say good evening to you, and we say once again congratulations to all our achievers, and bear in mind, 6 graduations from UTT, surely your responsibility. And at this stage, I would ask honored guests,
please stand and remain in your places until the procession, inclusive of graduates and academic staff, have retired. Congratulations again. Thank you.